So, as if you can't tell by the stage, this week is the week of VBS, starting tonight. Tonight, 6:30 through Thursday, every night, 6:30 to 8:30. I just want to start off and really thank everyone that has helped, has sent up prayers for VBS. We've had probably 15 people, roughly 15 people, come out and help with decorations at different stages.
We came to help you promote Vacation Bible School. We heard about it.
No. I thought this was the 30th anniversary Gilligan reunion.
We've done that one.
Oh.
That was after the second escape from the island. We're here to help. We flew all the way in
from Gilligan's Island.
Well, no, they actually sold that. Sandals bought it, built a bunch of condos. It's gone.
But this looks a lot like it, yeah?
It does. It does.
Cool.
Watch out.
Stevie,
you're hopeless. We're here to help. What do you need us to do?
What can you do?
We're famous. We're famous. We could do TV, we could do radio, we could do telegraph, whatever.
Sure, what this needs is a little celebrity endorsement.
Yeah, celebrity endorsement.
We can help. Yes.
We can help.
Hey!
No.
We're here. Anything you need, we're here. Oh, I know what you need.
Okay.
He needs some music. We can help with music.
We can help with music.
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 What music teachers.
We can help with music. What song could we sing?
That's a great idea.
And we're going to sing a song that everybody knows. Hey, Marianne. Everybody knows Amazing Grace. We're going to sing Amazing Grace. Stand up.
We got none to, yeah.
Whoa. That's not how you sing Amazing Grace. You sing Amazing Grace, we learned, the way we learned it in Merchant Marine School. When we were in the Merchant Marine, we sang it this way. Are you ready? Hit it, Marianne.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. And when he'd been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
It's all yours now.
See it this evening, right? You never know with those two. Again, thanks for everyone that came out for decorations. We had roughly 15 people throughout the time of doing decorations. I know Thelma was very instrumental in doing that, and she had illness with her mother, and but I especially want to thank Thelma, coordinating all the decorations and getting everyone times to meet and everything like that. So I want to especially thank Thelma. Workers, if you're going to work with VBS, I would like for everyone that's going to work with VBS to be out tonight at 5:30. Yes, VBS starts at 6:30. I'd like to go around to each of the stations, the locations that we're going to have the kids, and I'd like to say prayer. We're going to divide up and have prayer over these locations. Prepare the hearts for the kids that are coming. I know the Lord's already been working on these kids that are coming, but I'd like to divide out throughout the church, not only here, but back in the chapel, back in the nursery, over in the gym, over in a fireplace room in the gym. We've really expanded out, worked throughout the church and using multiple areas this year. One thing I can ask if you're not going to be here throughout the week of VBS, pray for us. Send up prayers for us. Traveling mercies, right now the weather's not looking so great, so games may get moved inside. That's perfectly fine. We can still have a great time. The kids are going to learn and hear the gospel no matter what. Jesus is going to rescue these kids every day. He rescues us every day, but he's going to show them how he can rescue them daily too. So pray for us. Invite your kids, invite your neighbors, invite your grandkids. Have them come out this week. Like I say, 6:30 to 8:30, Sunday through Thursday. Jonathan?
Well, good morning. I just want to welcome you all here this morning. And quick question, okay, if you can read, say amen. Good. All right, so we don't need announcements. You all read the bulletin. No, just kidding. No, check the bulletin out. There's some announcements in there. I'd love for you to just be aware of that. A few things that I want to highlight, though, of course, are VBS. That does begin tonight, and we're very excited about that and how God's going to work in and through that. As well, we just want to welcome those who are, maybe this is your first time here and you're visiting today. Thanks for being here. And we have a little slip inside the bulletin. If you want to take that out and fill that out, we'd love to know that you were here this morning, and you can either put that in one of the offering boxes or visit the visitor center in the back, and we'd love for you to do that. Also, there is a special date coming up, and we want you to come out for the wedding on Saturday, the 14th of July. Okay, so coming up here in just about a month, 14th of July, it'll be at 7 o'clock right here at Daniel's Missionary Church. And they've asked, the Jacksons have asked that you would please RSVP, okay? They look like this. They're in the back in a basket. And so if you could do that, fill those out, turn those in as soon as possible, and just put that in the basket back there, and that would be of great help to them. Another thing also in the bulletin as well, and most of you are familiar with this, but our prayer list is on that tear out. Please be in prayer for those here in our church family and even friends and family of our church family here. I know that they would appreciate your prayers, and prayer is a powerful tool. Now, one other announcement that I want to make, a little biased on this one, I guess, because I'm excited about this opportunity. But this Saturday over at Alpine Ministries, the camp that I work at, we've got a special kind of one-time deal going on. We've got some openings, and so we're trying to fill the gaps. But we have a whitewater rafting trip that I want to offer and make available to anyone here, or if you know somebody that you think would enjoy that. Maybe even an unsafe friend or family member that you know it'd be good to surround them with believers and in a Christian ministry. But it's open to you guys as well. This Saturday, the 16th of June, we're going to have a rafting trip. It's typically about $95-96 to go rafting. We're offering it for $25. So you can pretty much bring a family of four for one. Okay, so it's a great deal. You can't beat it. It's not going to come all the time. So this is pretty rare, so jump on it if you can. But it's this Saturday. It's a full day, okay? It begins around 9:30 in the morning, and you'll probably get back around 4:30. But lunch is included, okay? So for $25, you get some great rafting and lunch included. So again, as many of you are able to do that, we'd love to have you and invite you over. I'm going to be somewhere around in the auditorium or in the back afterwards, and I've got just some little slips of paper about contact info and how to reserve your spot. But again, I'd welcome you to do that. We'd love to have some of you come. And so mark that on your calendars this Saturday, the 16th. $25, all right? So great deal. All right, let's take just a quick moment. Let's open our service this morning in prayer, and then we'll continue with some worship after that. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. And Lord, we're grateful that we can come together freely and worship you, honor you, and praise you because, God, you deserve it. Lord, we thank you for the sunshine that we even were able to experience this morning as we came in. And Lord, we just are grateful again for the lives that you've given us. Help our time this morning to be meaningful, worshipful, and Lord, humble our hearts and prepare our hearts for what you'd have to speak to us through the pastor's message this morning. Lord, we love you. We give you the praise and glory and honor that you deserve. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, as the music team comes up here, the first song we're going to sing this morning is Wonderful, Merciful Savior. And I'd love to have you guys just stand and join with us as we sing that. We're going to sing the first two verses and then the chorus, and then the third verse and the chorus following that. It'll be up on the screen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh,
this morning we just sang about our wonderful, merciful Savior. Now we're going to sing about the wonderful cross. When you think about a cross, an instrument of torture, of death, how can that be wonderful? I was reading yesterday about the goodness of God, and he says, you know, of the attributes of God, the goodness of God is like the crown jewel, and of the goodness of God at the blazing center, he says, is his slaughter of the Lamb of God. You think about what we have in Christ because of his death, because he was slain for us. And you think about that cross, and I think, how wonderful for me, for you. So let's sing this morning about the wonderful cross.
When I survey the prince of glory.
Thanks for your great singing this morning. If you want to take a few minutes, go ahead and just fellowship with one another.
We have one announcement we need to make yet. The teenagers need to have a meeting over here right after the service.
And the parents.
Why don't you just come up and make this announcement?
It's not just for the camp.
It's not just for the camp.
All the teens and parents.
Teens and parents. Or anybody else who wants to come.
Sure.
Don't want to limit it, right?
No.
And that's going to be right up here where you guys are. Okay. That's good. A lot of sand on the stage. It gets in your shoes. You know how that is when you go to the beach, it drives you nuts. Have you been there? Yeah. All right. Well, this is the big time, isn't it? VBS is coming up tonight. And we should have been preparing ourselves for it, right? Praying, asking, talking to people about it. Right, Junior? Junior's been helping. He's been working. All this is part of you. You don't want to take credit for it. Yeah, I know that you got Gilligan destroying things. That's scary, just putting those two together. You got to watch who you eat. That's not good for you. That could be why he's not around today, right? Open your Bibles to the book of Acts today. We're going to do something that's a little bit different. I'm going to take the book of Acts, chapter 27. I want you to give me a little literary license this morning, and we're going to look at some areas that we need to be thinking about. Our theme for our vacation Bible school is shipwrecked. Shipwrecked. To be rescued by Christ. And I hope all of you here have been rescued by Christ. That's so important, isn't it? To know Jesus, to know Him intimately, to know that when this life is over, you have another life that starts automatically. Eternal life doesn't happen when you're dead. It happens right now while you're alive. Jesus gives us eternal life, and we'll never perish. And so that's something that we can praise Him for even today. Amen? Amen. I said amen.
Amen.
Are you praising Him this morning?
Amen.
Oh, Russ, I worry about you so much. Acts chapter 27 tells the story. I'm not going to read it all to you, but it tells the story of Paul. He's being taken to Rome. And, of course, as he goes through there, and you know the story, because you're faithfully readers of your Bible. Can I have an amen about that?
Amen.
That's right. Paul's going to Rome, and he runs into all kinds of problems. He realizes that they probably shouldn't have went when they did. In September, it was after the feast days, after the Day of Atonement. When that day occurred, usually sailors didn't get much on the Mediterranean Sea because of the winds that would come up, and it would play havoc with the sailors. So they didn't sail very much. They tried to find a port and stay there until the weather changed. But they tried to go into Rome, and they didn't quite make it. And I want you to look down with me, if you will. It says in verse 22, chapter 27. Are you there? Chapter 27, verse 22. All right. Hey, you guys in the back, next time we have church service, why don't you just plug it up here? I want to see a miracle take place in our church. Billy, I got your seat right here. I'll even put a cup holder on it for you. You just can't have anything in here because it's the auditorium, but you can have a nice cup holder.
He needs two seats.
What's that?
He needs two seats.
I didn't say it, Billy. Ted said that. I just want you to know where it came from. All right. Verse 22. And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. There are 276 people aboard this ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of God to whom I belong and whom I serve, saying, do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar, and indeed God has granted you all those who sail with you. Therefore take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told to me. However, we must run aground on a certain island. And he talks some more, but look at verse 29. Then fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And if you go back to verse 40, down to verse 40, it says, and they let go the anchors that they had dropped before, all four, and left them in the sea, meanwhile losing their rudder ropes, and they hoisted the mainsail to the wind and made for shore. And we'll just pause there for a minute. They dropped four anchors to try to secure themselves from going on the rocks. You know, when we look at something and we say, you know, this is where this is going, many times we look in our own power and our own strength, and we're not even asking God what is best for us to do. These sailors, these 200 and some sailors and people aboard the ship, didn't know Christ. Paul was the one that God spoke to. And may I suggest to you that everybody was saved on that ship because of the Apostle Paul. A Christian makes a difference in this world. You need to understand that. Whether at work, whether at church, wherever you happen to be, being a child of God makes an impact. And you don't realize the impact that you can make. Here, Paul, because of who he was and what he was doing following the Lord, he saved the lives of everyone aboard that ship because of who he was and what God had planned for him. And in that same idea, you have to understand that God has a plan not just for Paul, but God has a plan for you. Have you ever thought about that? Because of who you are, you have an impact on those people around you. The problem that we have, though, we get our eyes off of God. We get our eyes on our problems, just as the guy named Peter did. You remember him? Everybody gives Peter down the river because of what he did. He got out of the boat, and he walked to the Lord, and he saw the waves, that they were really, really high, and the wind was very strong, and he began to sink. And he said, "Oh, Lord, save me." And God reached out his hand and lifted him up. And everybody said, "Oh, look at Paul, or look at Peter, he didn't have any faith." I'll tell you one thing, Peter got out of the boat and he walked on the water. I don't know too many other people who have ever done that, do you? I know of one, though. Jesus did, that's right. And so we need to realize that God has called us to be different. God has called us to be salt to this world. God has called us to make a difference with those around us. The problem with that is Satan has a desire for you. And he wants you to be corrupted. He wants you not to fulfill the place that God has put you in this world, and to fulfill the plan that God has for you. That's his desire, is to shipwreck you. Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says, "I was shipwrecked three times." Phyllis, three times. Can you imagine that? Once wasn't enough. Twice wasn't enough. Three times he was shipwrecked. But he kept going. I've seen so many Christians, and I use that name in quotes, who have found themselves in difficult times, difficult storms, difficult troubles, and they get shipwrecked, and they don't come back. Do you know people like that? You need to make sure you're not like that. How do you do that, though? How do I make sure I don't become like that, that I fulfill God's purpose and plan for my life? You need to drop your anchors. There's four anchors that says that they dropped. And I want to give you four anchors. You can write these down in your Bibles or write these down in your mind or write them down in your neighbor's Bible for that matter, because he's probably not writing in his Bible. So you can write in his Bible for him. Four anchors. Are you ready? Here we go. Look at verse 22 and 23 again. "And now I urge you to take heart," he's talking to those, "for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of God, to whom I belong and to whom I serve, saying, 'Do not be afraid.'" Over 360 times you find that phrase in the scriptures, "Stop being afraid." We are children of God. God has promised never to leave us, never to forsake us. He dwells within us. "Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world." No matter what comes in this world, I have Christ's presence in my life. And nothing or no one can ever change that marvelous truth. I have God in my life. So what's the first anchor that you have to have in your life if you're going to go through this world and be victorious in fulfilling his plan and purpose for your life? It's his presence. It's God in your life. The first anchor is God. You have to know him intimately. You have to know him intimately because that's what eternal life is. John chapter 17, 3, you've heard me say it a million different times since I've been here as your pastor. And this is life eternal. He defines it for you, that you might know thee, the one true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Jesus defines eternal life as having intimate knowledge of who God is. Of who God is. Do you know God that way? The two great commandments that God has given to us is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Do you fulfill those two plans? To know God as he wants you to know him, he becomes the preeminent one of your life. You live your life not for your family or for the church or for anybody else. You live your life for God because it's his life. You see, you were crucified with Christ. That means you were put to death. Now Christ is living his life through you. You were bought with a price. Jesus Christ came to this earth and died on that cross and bore in his body your sins, and he paid your sin debt. He died your death. Isn't that a marvelous thing to think about? That's why we should think about Jesus all the time. He did that for me. He died in my place and allowed the Father to pour out upon him all the wrath that was due me for all eternity. He suffered my hell in those few hours that he was upon that cross. And he could do that because he was God Almighty. He did that for me. And understanding the scope of that and the depth of that and realizing that God has given me eternal life, something I could never deserve. But he's given it to me because of his marvelous grace. He needs to become the preeminent one of my life. Every thought should be about him. Every speaking that I have with anybody in my community, I need to be talking to them about what I have experienced through Jesus Christ. And so we have a position, don't we? We have a position in the person of God. But we allow many things to take away that preeminence, that purpose. And we begin to float through this world. You have to hold on to that anchor. You have to hold on to that relationship you have with God, because that's what's going to hold you strong through whatever comes to your life. It could be your husband. It could be your wife. It could be a child dying. It could be a million different things. And if you don't have God as your anchor, you have nothing. You have no hope. You have to have it in the person of God. Because when you have that aspect of having that relationship, that's exactly what you have. Not just I'm in the person of God, but I have a relationship. I have a sonship with God. I'm in His family. I'm a son of God. You're a daughter of God. It says in John chapter 1, verse 12, but as many as received Him, that's speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, He gave them the right to become children of God, even to those who believe on His name. You have the right to believe and to become children of God. Why? Because God has done this for you. So as you sit there here today, you need to remind yourself of who He is and what He's given to you. He is your anchor in this life. Every job you have, every blessing you have, comes from His hand. And the Lord giveth and the Lord can taketh away. That's why we need to make sure that we're never chastened by God, that our heart's always right, that we're confessing our sins before Him, receiving that cleansing so we can glorify Him with the life that we have. You have to realize that I am a child of God. I am a son. I am a daughter of God. And no one can take that away from me. But I also have the opportunity not to, you know, just revel in the aspect that I'm saved. I have, because of who I am as a child of God, an opportunity to serve Him. To serve Him. You know, in the Old Testament, when a servant wanted to stay with his master because he loved his master, loved his family, he could stay by having his ear pierced with an awl, voluntarily shedding his blood for his master to say, I belong to Him. Do people where you work know that you belong to Him? Young people, when you go to school, do people at school know that you belong to Him? You've heard me say this before. We had a little boy in our school, in the high school. His father was a big preacher of a large church in our area. And he would pass out these little tracts, you know. You've heard me say it before, Joe. It would say, Jesus, if you turn it certain ways, you know, that was kind of neat. You know, back in those days, I don't see things like this. But we made fun of that boy because he was weird. All he talked about was this Jesus stuff. I didn't know anybody else talked about this Jesus stuff. None of my friends talked about Jesus ever, unless it was a cuss word. But nobody ever talked like this boy did. And all we did was make fun of him. But I don't remember him ever not giving out those little cards or talking about Jesus periodically to people. He never quit. But all my friends never would do that. And I know that I have lost friends in my life because of my relationship to Christ. And so you come down to that, are you going to live for Christ or not live for Christ? Is He going to be the sole purpose of your life, or is the world going to become the sole purpose of your life? See, that's where we have trouble, Christians. We get involved so much into this world that we forget who we belong to. We forget our position in Christ, that I've been adopted into His family. And I've been adopted into His family for a purpose, and my purpose is to serve this one who loved me and gave Himself for me. Do you realize that? Are you serving this one? What a blessing we have. What a joy it is to know that I can serve God Almighty with my life. He has a purpose for me. And he says in verse 24, because I have this purpose, he says, Paul, don't be afraid. No matter what comes into your life, no matter how difficult it is, remember, God says, don't be afraid. Maybe you can't pay your bills. Maybe it's a sickness. Maybe it's a million different things. He tells you, don't be afraid. Why? Because of who He is. Because of who He is. That's a proclamation that He's given to you. Tim Dillon, stop being afraid. I know when I had this area in my chest, and I guess I still could have it, I don't know, not until July. You start wondering when he says you could have lymphoma, Tim, you know, and I'm thinking, you're out of your mind. What's a doctor know? I mean, I got things to do. And I kind of told him that. You know, the church just called me as a pastor a couple years ago. I can't go up and die on them now. If I do that, they'll have to have another pulpit committee, and they went crazy last time looking for one. And after me, they may not want to have another one. Joe, I don't know how that works. But you see, I don't know what God's going to do, but he gives it a proclamation, and we read it in the Bible, and we say, oh, I'm not afraid, until it happens in your life. Until it's you. I can give you great advice. Oh, don't be afraid. It's going to be okay, but I don't know it's going to be okay. I don't usually say that. It's whatever the Lord wants. And that's how I pray. Lord, take this away. You know I want to stay around here for a while. But not my will be done, your will be done. It's easy to say that until it's you. And then you have to live it. Those words, don't be afraid, have to mean something to you. To realize that even if you die in this life, there is a life to come. We talk about it, but it's not always real to us, is it? But it is real. And Jesus is coming. Whether by death or by the rapture of the church, Jesus is coming for each one of us. And so that proclamation that he makes here, stop being afraid, needs to take root in our life where we live out that phrase by faith. Stop being afraid because of who he is and what he's given to us. I think about the Apostle Paul. Well, I'll skip that. I'll get to it in a minute. And so that's the first anchor. What's the first anchor you have to have? God, a deep relationship with this one who loves you. If you don't, you're going to get shipwrecked. You're never going to grow. You're never going to become what God wants you to be. We have a lot of stunted Christians in this world today. You believe that? God expects us to be up here, and we're happy. We're content. Every day brings something new, something different. A deeper relationship. I get to know him better. Can't wait for what tomorrow might bring. I don't know. But it might bring Jesus. So the first anchor is God. The second one is verse 25. Therefore, he says, take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told to me. Therefore, take heart, he says, for I believe God. That's the second one. Faith. I believe God. You know, to have God as your anchor, what do you have to have first and foremost? Without faith, it's impossible to please him. You have to believe that he is. Look in your Bibles in 2 Corinthians real quick, chapter 11. Here's the Apostle Paul. Did the Apostle Paul have issues in his life? I mean, let's face it, he wrote half the New Testament. I mean, he is the apostle of apostles. They look at him today and say that he was the greatest missionary of all time. The Apostle Paul. And so we think that he had a great life, no troubles, no problems. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, he talks about different things that has happened to him. If I can get there. Verse 23, I think it is. He says, are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in labors, more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequently, in death often. From the Jews 5 times I received 40 stripes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I have spent in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness. Let me catch my breath. In perils in the sea, in perils among the false brethren, in weariness and toil and sleeplessness often, as hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides the other things. The other things. I mean, here is Paul talking about he is God's chosen vessel. I believe in God. Then God, why are you allowing all of this stuff to happen to me? I mean, I have served you faithfully. Why me? You know, Paul never said that, did he? He says, I bear in my body the marks of the Lord. See, he realized that all those different things that was happening to his life that we would look at to be so terrible, and we have them in our life as well, were part of God's plan for him. You see, God doesn't see like we see. He doesn't think like we see, but he plans above what we can understand. And so what we think is a terrible thing, to him it's a good thing. You see? Even though Paul was going through a terrible time with all these different things, it was part of God's plan. Why? Because he had faith, he knew who God was, and he knew the purpose that he was called. He believed in God. I go back to the book of Acts again when you talk about Silas and Paul. What were they doing? Well, they were just out preaching the word to people, and they ended up getting tossed into prison, Mike. And what happened to them in prison? They got put in stocks. They got beat. And what did they do all night long? What most of us would do, they would have moaned and groaned. Oh, look what's happening to me. This isn't right. That's not what they did at all. They realized that was part of God's plan and purpose. Even though they were in prison, hey, they had an audience. So they sang. They worshiped. And it had an impact on those around them. You see, faith is the key to knowing God. Do you today, and can you say that I believe God? Not in God. I believe God. No matter what he brings into your life, no matter how bad it is, can you still praise him for it? Can you say it's part of your plan? How do you know it's part of his plan? Because it's happened to you. Nothing can happen to you unless God allows it to happen to you. That's the power of God. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. So there's a plan and purpose for you. So can you say that you have the anchor of God in your life? Can you say that you have the anchor of faith? I believe God. No matter what comes into my life, I can say I believe him. Because if you can't, you're going to shipwreck. And that's not what you want, is it? I don't think it is at all. And so we talked about the first anchor, which is God. The second anchor, which is faith. Oh, let me give you one more thought, speaking of Paul. We know when he went to Lystra, he preached the gospel. I can remember when I was thinking about going out and becoming a pastor, going back to school and becoming a pastor. Dwayne, I don't know, you went when you were older too. Now you're just old. You're older then, now you're old, right? You know, we left wherever we were doing what we were doing, and we stepped out in faith, and we went to school to learn to be a pastor and that sort of thing. Difficult times. Not knowing what's ahead, not knowing what's going to happen, not knowing where you're going to go or what you're going to do. But walking by faith and trusting the Lord. And so here was Paul preaching exactly what we want to do, preach the gospel. I don't think this is wonderful to stand in front of you folks and make a fool out of myself every Sunday. I'm a fool for Jesus. And you know I'm not the best speaker. I mispronounce words. I misspeak. But you know what? Hey, you're stuck with me because God said so. I didn't say he did, right? But here's Paul preaching in Lystra, and they don't like him. And people come up and they stir up a hornet's nest about him, and they end up stoning him. I mean, this guy's having a bad run of luck. Everywhere he goes, he's supposed to be praising God, doing great things for God, but here he's getting stoned. I'm not talking about the drinking or the smoking. I'm talking about taking rocks and hitting him. And they drug him out. They drag him outside the city. Why? Because they assume he's what? D-E-A-D. And for those of you who didn't go to school, that spells dead. They think he's dead. And I think he probably was dead. Because in 2 Corinthians 12, he says, hey, I know this guy who ascended up into the third heaven. And he's speaking about himself, I think. I think Paul died. God raised him to life. Because God wasn't done with him yet and the purpose that he had for Paul. And he's not done with you yet. So even though he slays me, there's a purpose in my life. There's a purpose in my life. And so you have to say, I know who God is. He's my anchor. And I'm going to walk by faith. And I believe God no matter what comes in my life. That's how Paul was. And we need to be using him as an example in our life. Now look at verse 31. I'll give you the third anchor. Let me just read verse 31. Then fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship, when they had let down the skiff into the sea, under pretense of putting out anchors from the prow, Paul said to the centurion and to the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. You cannot be saved. You have to stay in the ship. Stay in the ship. this is where I want to use a little bit of literary license. Staying in the ship. For us, we're not in a ship. We're in the church. This is where you get the power that you need. This is where you get instruction that you need. This is where God's people gather together. Jesus Christ died to create what we call the church. And the church can meet anywhere. It can meet outside. It can meet in the fellowship hall. It can meet over in the Family Life Center. It can meet here. This is where the church is because Christ is here with us. And the church has gathered for the purpose of glorifying God. Saying, I believe in Jesus. What is the purpose of the church? Why are you part of the church? Look in your Bibles again to Matthew, if you will. Matthew chapter 16. This is the purpose that you have. Matthew 16, and look down at verse 18. This is where the Catholics get a little confused. And let's go to verse 17 and get the context. Jesus answered and said to him, Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Who's building the church? Jesus is building the church. I will build my church, and the gates of Hades, the gates of hell, shall not prevail against it. The church is the mechanism that God has created to combat Satan in this world. We are beating down the doors of hell, the doors of Hades. That's what we are. We're on the offensive. We're moving forward. We're claiming victory after victory after victory because we have victory in Jesus. True? We have that victory in Jesus. Is the church really on the offensive? It seems to me so often that the church is always on the defensive. We're bickering and arguing, fighting over stupid things that really has nothing to do with the kingdom of God, but has everything to do with my own pride and what I desire in my life or what I want for the church. It isn't for you to decide what you want for the church. It's for Jesus to decide what he wants for the church because he's building his church. And he's building it the way that he wants it. And he has placed you here in this place so you can combat Satan and those spiritual wickedness in high places. You can combat those things here in the church. It has a purpose. We're at war. And you have to be in the ship. The church is so, so important. How important is the church? Christ died to create it. You know, I think of today, as a pastor, I get offended when I have a small crowd in church. It used to bother me a lot when I was younger. I don't know if you did, you, Dwayne, as a pastor. You know, I said, man, where's everybody at? I've said it here. I've sat out there, and, you know, Baptists don't come till 5 or 10 after, you know. Where's everybody at? The church is important. You know, people go out and they take vacations, and there's nothing wrong with taking vacations. I love to take vacations. I'm dressed to take one now. I want to get shipwrecked in Hawaii. You have to understand that God gives you money to buy your automobiles. Is that true? Everything you have comes from who? Comes from God. And so he gives us these cars that we can use for his glory, but we use them many times not to come to church, not to grow and to learn. We skip things that we ought not skip so we can grow and become what he wants us to be. Cars and our money. We spend our money on all kinds of things, and sometimes we spend our money so well that we don't have enough money to give to God. Is that true? How many times have you talked to people and said, I love to tithe? And by the way, we don't tithe in the New Testament. We have grace giving. The Old Testament was tithing. As God has blessed, we give. It could be little. It could be a lot. But so many people can't give at all because they're so far into debt. That's not good. So what should you do? Work on getting out of debt. So you can do what? Glorify God. Because it's important for his church to do what? Move forward. We're at war. We need those supplies to keep moving forward. God has given us our homes that we live in. How often, well, in my house, you know, I get up early sometimes, but sometimes I would just like to stay in bed. and turn over and just go back to sleep. Of course, the older I get, the less that happens. I don't sleep very well as I get older. It's how it is. He's given me this house. He's given me this bed. He's given me the opportunity to relax, but I got to get up and come to church. But, you know, I could skip it today. I'm just going to roll over. It's not important to me. Is that how you are? If that's how you are, you don't have that anchor. That anchor, which is the church, which is your ship, is struggling in the surf, and it needs you. So we talked about three anchors so far. What's the first one? God. Second one? Faith. The third one? The church or your ship. And then the last one. Look at verse 33. And as the day was about to dawn, Paul implored them all to take food, saying, "Today is the 14th day. You have waited and continued without food and eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival." The last one is food. Now, from the spiritual aspect of this, the spiritual aspect for our application, I guess, for this story, is to realize that our food isn't just the pizza that we eat, or the steak that we eat, or the hamburgers that we eat, or the hot dogs that we eat, or whatever you're going to eat whenever you're going to eat it. He's talking about spiritual food. I'm talking about spiritual food, needing the spiritual food to make us what we are. And if you're not reading the scriptures and understanding the scriptures and seeking to have God fill your heart and mind with the scriptures, you're starving to death. If you only open your Bible when you come to church, and to learn what the Bible says only by what the pastor speaks or what the Sunday school teacher teaches, you're starving to death. You're never going to become what God wants you to be. You're never going to have the type of faith that you need to have. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You need the Word of God. You need to chew on it. It needs to become part of your life. There's purposes for it. What are those purposes? Well, look at verse 34. And when he had said these things, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, they began to do what? They began to eat. Verse 34. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival. Scripture, reading the scripture, will ensure that you are a healthy Christian. Does that make sense? A healthy Christian. So many Christians say, "Well, I know what I believe, but I don't know where it is." That's the problem. We have an idea of what the Word of God teaches, but we don't know where it is in the Bible because we don't spend enough time with our Bibles to know where it is. But the food that we need is going to ensure us good health. And also said, so this is for your survival. This is for your survival. Your safety. Your safety. You know, I don't know about you, but when I went to see the doctor recently, the same guy who came into the hospital room, he was telling me that, "I remember you. You were in room 232 or whatever it was." I said, "Yeah." I'm thinking, this guy's pretty sharp. And then he started talking, "Yeah, your wife was there." And then he started talking about what he was telling me, and he said, "You didn't like what I was telling you." And I said, "No, I didn't like what you were telling me. I mean, he's just a doctor. What's he really know? I don't have to like it." And he's telling me all these things, you know. But when you nourish yourself on the scriptures, there's safety. No matter what comes, I know whom I have believed in, and I am persuaded that he is what? Able to do what? You name it. He's able. I find safety in Christ. I'm believing in God, not that he just exists, but I have a personal, intimate relation with him. I walk by faith. I'm fulfilling my purpose through his church, and I know that no matter what comes in my life, I am safe, and nothing can ever take that away from me. And the more I know of him from this word, the more I change and I'm transformed into his image. And so when that time comes for me to step out of this world into eternity, I can say, I know who I'm going to see. I don't know about him. I know him. And that's the difference between 90% of the Christians in this world today. They don't know him. They know of him, but they don't know him. Because if you knew him, you'd be reading your scriptures, you'd be in church all the time, you'd be studying the scriptures because you'd be praising for who he is and what he's given to you. And there's a difference. And so we have good health, we have safety. Look at verse 36, if you will. Then they were all encouraged. I don't know, sometimes I need to be cheered up. I need to be cheered up. This is where I get cheered up sometimes. I need other things too, but when I realize who God is and what he's given to me, it makes me feel good. Is there anything wrong with feeling good as a Christian? No, I think I should feel good. I have that desire to feel good, and I feel good when I know who he is. And then the last aspect of this idea of food, verse 44. And the rest, they're heading for land. And the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was that they all escaped safely to land. They made it to shore. Praise God. Amen. I'm guaranteeing you, if you have these anchors, what's the first one? God. What's the second one? Faith. What's the third one? Ship. The church. And the last one is? The word. Nourishment. Food. If you have all four of those anchors, you're going to make it to shore. And it's not this shore. It's the shore that's coming. Are you ready for it? You know, that doctor, when he told me that, he kind of put my mind back into the reality that Tim's not as healthy as Tim thought he always was. It could happen to me. Preaching it and living is two different things. It helped me kind of readjust my thinking to say, I know whom I believed in. I'm just not talking about faith, God. I believe in it. Whatever you want. But I had to come to grips with that again. It's been a while since I've had to do that. Do you know God? Are you walking by faith? Even if you're having bad things in your life, can you really say, I know him? I'm faithful to him. I'm eating his word because it's precious to me. Because without it, you'll starve to death as a child of God. And are you involved in his church? He died to create this thing that you belong to, because this thing, this church, is his body. And he's allowed you to become part of who he is. I don't know if we'll ever understand what that means, the depths of what that thought is. But God wants you to be successful. You can't be successful unless you're born again, unless you know Jesus Christ as your Savior. We hear this all the time. But I have to say it, because someday you're going to stand before God. Whether at the judgment seat of Christ or the bema seat, wherever it's going to be, you're going to be at a good place or a bad place. Which one is it? If you don't know him, it's the bad place. But if you know him, it's the good place. So can you say today, by your life, that I know Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior? Can you say that? Is there enough evidence in your life to convict you of being a Christian? For many people, there isn't. So I hope that today, as you think about it, if you are a child of God and you know for sure that if you were to die tonight and stand before him and he was to say to you, why shall I let you into heaven? You would say, because I have trusted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and he's given me eternal life, and God doesn't make mistakes. If you can say that, I want you to stand up here this morning. And if you can't say that, you can become a child of God by just coming and talking to me and opening up your heart and your mind to who he is. And accepting the forgiveness that he offers so freely. Isn't it great? God has made it so simple. God has given us so much to be victorious, so much to be happy. And I see so many cheerless Christians sometimes. Let's put a smile on our face. Amen? When I die and they lay me out here someplace, I'm going to have them put a smile on my face. Super glue does wonders. But I'm going to be smiling, maybe not here, but up there for sure. I can't imagine what it's going to be like. But Lord, let's not go today. Amen? But see, we have to say, if it's today, amen. I tell you, if the bus pulled up out there, I'd get on it right now, wouldn't you? We say that, but do you really mean it? I hope that you do. I hope that if you're not involved in VBS, you can come back. And just participate in helping and just watching and just being part of what we are. VBS has a big impact on little kids. And a lot of our older kids have worked really hard to put all this stuff together. and we should praise them for that. Having a heart for children is a good thing. Right, Megan? She said, I have a heart for children. I'm just so glad it's summertime. Amen. And so I hope that you have these anchors in your life. Amen. Let's pray together, and we'll be dismissed. And if you need to talk to me about something in your life, some spiritual aspect maybe of whether or not you're saved, I'm always here. Love to talk to you. That's what I'm here for. You come and find me. I'll be here all afternoon, and this evening I'll be here too. Let's pray together.